My name is Dr. Frances Perrin, Executive Clinical Director here at Brett DiNovi Associates. This video discusses the distinction between positive and negative reinforcement, which is item B4 on the BACB 6th edition test content outline. If you are or have been a student of behavior analysis, you likely encountered challenges in fully grasping the distinction between positive and negative reinforcement. Despite its status as a foundational concept in behavior analysis, the necessity of this distinction has been a topic of debate for decades. In 1975, Jack Michael questioned the clarity of positive-negative reinforcement differentiation, suggesting it might be better to abandon it altogether. 30 years later, Barron and Galizio revisited this issue in The Behavior Analyst, arguing that these terms add little functional significance. The following year, prominent behavior analysts, including Brian Iwata and Murray Sidman, entered the discussion, offering both support for and opposition to maintaining the distinction. This ongoing debate raises important questions. Does maintaining the distinction enhance our understanding of behavior, or does it complicate our work without providing substantial benefit? Let's examine some of the arguments from both sides to determine whether this distinction should remain central to behavior analysis or be reconsidered for a more streamlined approach. The first argument is that maintaining the distinction gives us clarity in understanding mechanisms. Positive reinforcement involves the addition of stimulus, for example, giving a reward, following a behavior, which increases the likelihood of that behavior occurring again. Negative reinforcement involves the removal of an aversive stimulus, for example, turning off a loud noise, following a behavior, which also increases the likelihood of that behavior. This distinction helps clarify the different mechanisms by which behavior can be strengthened. By specifying whether a stimulus is added or removed, behavior analysts can better understand and communicate how reinforcement operates in a given context. A second argument is practical application. In applied settings, understanding whether behavior is maintained by positive or negative reinforcement can inform intervention strategies. For example, if a child's behavior is maintained by negative reinforcement, for example, escaping a difficult task, the intervention might focus on teaching alternative ways to escape or cope with the task, rather than simply providing rewards. The third argument for maintaining the distinction is theoretical and experimental precision. The distinction allows for more precise experimental analysis. Researchers can design studies to specifically test the effects of positive versus negative reinforcement, leading to a deeper understanding of behavior processes. Arguments against maintaining the distinction. The first is complexity and confusion. The distinction can sometimes lead to confusion, especially for those new to behavior analysis. The terms positive and negative can be misinterpreted as good and bad, which is not the case in technical terms. Negative reinforcement is often confused with punishment. This can create unnecessary complexity in teaching and understanding reinforcement principles. A second argument against the distinction is functional equivalence. Both positive and negative reinforcement ultimately increase the likelihood of a behavior, suggesting that the distinction might not be necessary from a functional perspective. What matters in practice is that the behavior is reinforced, not necessarily whether a stimulus was added or removed. The third argument against the distinction is that you can't always clearly interpret whether a stimulus change involves positive or negative reinforcement. This highlights the inherent overlap between the two processes. Essentially, producing a stimulus, positive reinforcement, often coincides with escaping a situation that stimulus was absent, negative reinforcement. Similarly, removing a stimulus, negative reinforcement, creates a situation in which absence of the stimulus can be seen as a form of positive reinforcement. For example, giving a child praise for completing homework, which is positive reinforcement, also removes the aversive situation of not receiving praise, negative reinforcement. Likewise, turning off a loud noise, negative reinforcement, results in a quieter, more pleasant environment which could be interpreted as a positive reinforcement. This dual interpretation makes it difficult to definitively classify reinforcement as purely positive or negative, as both processes are often intertwined in any given scenario. Mm-hmm.